but you never know the reason why. You can read all the books in the library, you can wish upon a star in the sky, you can drink all the wine in the vineyard, but you never know the reason why. The times I've been broken are the times I wish I had spoken. You might have thought that I was joking, but you never know the reason, never know the reason why.
And welcome to the Strange Brew podcast. My name's Jason Barnard, and that's Mikael Rickfors and Reason Why from his forthcoming album. Mikael is one of the greatest names in Swedish music. Well known as being the singer for the Hollies in the 1970s, he's had his songs recorded by so many great artists, including Carlos Santana, Cyndi Lauper, Percy Sledge. And I'm very pleased to speak to Mikael today. Huge welcome, Mikael.
Thank you, Jason.
So we opened with Reason Why.
Yeah.
Can you tell me about the writing of that song?
Well, it's about, you know, decisions that we make on our journey, and that sometimes the decisions might have been not the great ones. But sometimes we make great decisions, and in the end, you know, we... time runs. The time is passing so fast, and it's about that. The wrong and right decisions we made through life.
Am I right that you wrote that song with one of your longtime songwriting partners?
Yes, yes. Hans Huss. We're still working, not that much that we used to do, but now and then, you know, the song here and the song there.
You've been writing with him for a long time.
Oh, many years. You know, I think we started mid-70s something. And actually, the first song we wrote was a song called Daughter of the Night.
Classic.
Yeah. And that's been recorded by a number of fantastic artists through the years.
So your background in childhood, am I right that you're from a musical family?
Yeah. My father was a violinist, and also he'd be upright bass in, you know, swing, jazz. Sort of, you know, during that time. And And my mother was a piano player, and my grandfather was singing in a choir, with very famous choir. So there was a lot of music on the family meetings, you know, which, you know, that's probably the reason I'm doing it now.
You started playing music very young then?
Yes, I started my first band, I think I was 12 years old. At that time, we played, you know, you remember the skiffle?
Yes, they had that in skiffle in Sweden as well.
Yeah, yeah. So that's the what we started. I was playing the, what do you call it, a washboard?
Yeah.
You know. So I started really young, early age.
When you were in your teens, you played bass in a covers band. Was it Katniss?
Yeah, that was for a short period. Katniss would actually... We were on a tour in the north of Sweden on a ski resort, and I was playing the bass that night. The guy who's the singer got a terrible cold. So who's going to sing now? Well, I don't know. You know, so Michael, you must sing. No, I can't sing. But then, you know, I sang, and that's I've been singing ever since. I think I was like 18 years old or something like that.
So after that, you were in the group Bamboo?
Yeah, that was a band I formed in Stockholm. We actually played for a couple of years. We did some minor tours in Europe, and we ended up as the support act for the Hollies here in Sweden. And that's how that started, you know. And Tony Hicks was he was keen on, you know, finding new talents and new bands because he wanted to start produce. So we went over and recorded in a studio in London with Tony as a producer. But unfortunately, the Bamboo as a recording band wasn't up to the thing. So nothing really happened with that. But later, was it some years later, or a year later, Mr. Robin Britton, who was the manager of the Hollies at that time, called me and asked if I wanted to, you know, come to London and sing a song, you know, and audition on the Air Studios. And I said, yes. I was really surprised that I got the job, because I thought that I didn't do a good job. But they said, you know, don't call us, we'll call you, and which I did, like a week later.
Even in Bamboo, you were writing songs, because one of the songs that was also recorded by the Hollies, Touch, you also recorded with Bamboo. So you were writing songs in Bamboo as well?
Yes, I did, yes. But I was writing poems, and that song was actually a poem in Swedish. So I translated it over to English. That was on the first record we did, on the album we did. Was it Romany? It was Romany, yeah.
Close but so far away. cold sea, the sun went down. Bright stars on the blue horn. In the hours of the night, all the sweetness touched my hand. Everything's close but so far away. Everything's given to people as a law.
Going back to the Hollies, you were asked to come to audition. This was the period where Alan Clark had left and they were looking for a new singer.
Yes, it's true. I flew over and the audition was at Air Studios in London. And I remember there was a line of English singers waiting the turn to audition. And we all learned the same song, I guess.
Was it The Baby, the song?
The Baby, yeah, it was The Baby. I remember, you know, I really tried hard to learn, and now I'm going to show them. And I started to sing. The first verse was okay. The second verse, not as good as I wanted it. And when the refrain came, I was totally out of tune. So I screamed, you know, in Swedish, "Fan," which means fuck. And I saw them jump in the room in the. And I said, uh-oh, that's it. Anyhow, so they called some week later and said, you got a job if you want it. And that was fantastic.
Did you like the Hollies in the 1960s?
Absolutely. You know, my band, we used to do a couple of Hollies tunes. So I really enjoyed them. And my favorites were the Hollies, the Kinks, the Who, the Beatles, all that kind of band.
Your vocal sound, especially on The Baby, is very soulful. Is that something that was natural, or did you also like soul artists?
Well, actually, to be honest, that was the thing that I wanted to do, because ever since I started to play the guitar and sing, I've been playing one of my favorite singers, was a guy called Snooks Eaglin, which he inspired me. And he was a great guitar player and a fantastic singer. Yeah, he caught me, you know. I really loved his stuff. So I was more into that. But and the stuff we did with the Bamboo was a lot of soul, like Four Tops and James Brown,
right,
and stuff like that. So the Hollies was a bit different for me. You know, I have a slightly deeper voice than Alan, and I really had to struggle to reach the high notes in the beginning. But after a while, it came natural, sort of.
The Baby was a hit single as well. So you were on the Top of the Pops here in Britain, weren't you?
Yeah, a couple of times, yeah.
What was it like coming over to England from Sweden? How did the music scene compare?
Well, you know, everything that was recorded and played in England or America was, you know, what we thought like 100 times better than we ever, you know, could do it. So I was very, I can't say scared, but a bit nervous.
Yeah.
In the beginning. I mean, also the language. I mean, you think you can speak English, but once you're there, you understand, well, I can't really, you know, I can't have a conversation. I have to think. So I was very nervous. And Top of the Pops was the biggest show in Europe at that time. So, but I made it.
Passing on the spring. By the child bride, while deep inside her lie the real truth. He was the passion of the spring, brother, we backs to each other, the war sang. And in the passion of the spring came the baby. Come back to mama, mama, singing the song. Tell him all that was wrong. Tell him all that you have, that was bad. Tell him all that was good, mama.
And Romani, recording that, how was that experience, the album?
I thought that was great because I think that Tony and the rest of the boys wanted to change the sound because at that time, you know, it was Crosby, Stills, Nathan Young and America and all those bands.
Yeah.
And they wanted to sort of slide in that sort of sound. And I think we succeeded. I thought it was a lot of great songs on Romani. Papa Rain and Romani. The song Romani, great, I think.
Lots of acoustic guitars and harmonies.
Yeah, a lot of acoustic guitars and a lot of harmonies, of course. Yeah, I was surprised because actually the songs were kind of complicated and it took me a while to learn them, you know, because they weren't really, they were complicated songs, you know, complicated melodies and chords and things like that. So it took me a while to learn, but. But listen to it now. If I'm listening to it now, I think it sounds pretty good.
Alan Parsons was the engineer, very famous producer.
Yeah, I loved him. He was a great guy. There was somebody there. So started with the Argent.
Rod Argent was a pianist who started Argent.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I remember that time. Yeah, fantastic. Very nice guy.
Magic Woman Touch. That was one of the other big singles.
Yeah, I think so. I know I still get letters from New Zealand, very, very popular. I don't think it made any charge in England or America.
The current Hollies band still play that song even to this day?
Yeah, I know, yeah. Because I met them. They were having a fantastic concert in Sweden some year, 2 years ago. And I went to the concert and I went backstage and met them. It was great fun. No, I remember, they still played it. I mean, I was with the baby.
Mm-hmm. was yesterday. All my life thrown away. Keep searching for the same old clue. How can I get to you?
Cast your spell upon me one more time. I wanna be your magic woman touch. Cast your spell upon me one more time. I wanna feel your magic woman touch.
I know there's been a change in me.
Ask me why, I don't know.
My friends no longer speak to me.
Pass me by, I don't know.
Romany is an album, it sold well in the United States, and listening now, it's actually one of the best Hollies albums, certainly from the 1970s, so that's definitely something to be proud of.
Yeah, I'm kind of proud of that, because actually, when I'm on tour now, I play Magic Woman Touch, and I play Romany sometimes, still, you know, and people love it.
And then singing live with the Hollies, how was it singing a mix of new and older material? Was that okay, given your difference in vocal style with Alan?
Yeah, as I said, you know, I mean, their harmonies, their higher pitched voices. So I had really to struggle for a while to reach the high notes. But on the very songs that was very, very, very high was Terry Sylvester, who took lead vocal. So I did a harmony to it or something like that. But it was, I was amazed, actually. We had, on the first tour, we had, the first gig was in Maine, some college in Maine. And we just been rehearsing after that moment. But once we were on stage, you know, it's like the intensity and the energy was amazing. So different from the rehearsal.
Yeah.
So that was very impressive.
There's footage of the Midnight Special TV show in America, which shows that. So Terry Sylvester sung Long Call Woman, and then you sung He Ain't Heavy, He's My Brother, and it both sounded really good.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Yeah, that was the Santa Monica Pacific Auditorium, if I remember right. And we had the honor to have a fantastic local band. The stage was totally full of Hammond organs and Marshall amplifiers and dancers and choirs, and it was so incredibly good. So then they took away all, they moved all their amplifiers and organs, and I remember we have one small Vox AC30, I think it was called.
Yes.
They look so small and innocent on this big stage. But it turned out good.
Years ago, the Hollies had the first major hit with a song that's now become a standard. He Ain't Heavy, He's My Brother. And once again, let's hear the Hollies.
So as you were in the Hollies for quite a while, you wrote more songs, and that included the single Don't Leave the Child Alone. So did you have great confidence in contributing songs to the band?
I remember we had a break for the summer, and we decided before the break that we should write some songs for the record, which I did. you know, I didn't think much about it. So when we met on Abbey Road to play our songs, well, I only wrote three songs, but they accepted all three of them, which I was really surprised and happy, of course.
There were some songs that you wrote with Terry Sylvester as well?
Yeah, I think we wrote one in New York. They Don't Realize I'm Down, I think it was called.
And around that time, it must have been strange that the Hollies had a hit single of an older track, Long Cool Woman.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you were releasing your own material. That must have been really weird.
No, not really. I was so shocked and I tried to blend in, you know, with the band, and I didn't think much about that. And of course, Terry sang that a long, cool woman so much better than I ever, you know, could have done.
You also toured Australia with the Hollies as well.
Yeah, yeah. Fantastic place to visit, of course. I haven't been there since, but it was different. Very, very friendly people, a lot of parties, and the audience was very happy. I think the Hollies were pretty popular in Australia at that time, anyhow. So it was a great experience.
What do you think of the Out on the Road album? Because that didn't get a full release because you'd left the group by the time it went out. Was that an album that you're fond of?
Not really. I think the Roman is so much better.
Right.
To be honest, I don't think it's one of the Hollis' best records.
July 1973, you left the group, and it seemed that things weren't working out for you, and things weren't working out for some of the group. So did it feel like the right thing to leave? Was it too much touring?
Yeah, it was. There was a lot of touring, and when you're on tour, you have to accept the fact that your home is a new hotel every day and every night, and that was a bit too much for me at the time. So we had this summer break, and I decided actually to call and say that I wanted to leave, and felt sad in a way, but that's what happened. And the thing is that when I talked to Robin Britton to tell him this, he said, "Well, Michael, that's good, because I was just about to call you and fire you."
Oh God!
So I was ahead of it.
See the moon from the same place where we used to play. A child bright shining as the sun. Don't be afraid, cause I know where it all begun. Don't say another word. I've heard all I need to hear. As it never in your lazy mind occurred. Only I know what you want to share. A child bright shining as the sun. Don't be afraid, cause I know where it all begun. See the moon from the same place where we used to play. A child bright shining as the sun. Don't be afraid, cause I know where it all began. Don't say another word. I've heard all I need to hear. Has it never in your lazy mind occurred? Only I know what you want to share. A child bright shining as the sun. Don't be afraid, cause I know where they all began.
very different situation now to recording solo material, because you must have been so much more confident to really start your solo career by the mid-1970s, given the experience you had with the Hollies?
Yes. Yes, of course. I mean, tour with the Hollies in America and Australia and in the rest of the world, I wasn't that scared, or I don't know how to express myself here.
Yes, you're more confident.
Yeah, more confident, right. And then when I started to write songs with my friend Hans Huss, which is an incredible poet and language, you know, he speaks English fluently, and both him and I was very confident when we released the first record of Daughter of the Night.
We've now got the Carlos Santana version. Listening to your original, I could see why Carlos Santana would love the track, because it's got a bit of a Santana feel, even in your version.
Yeah.
What was the sound you were aiming for when you first wrote and recorded that song?
It was some kind of folk blues kind of sound. I just bought a new Martin, a new, you know, guitar in New York, and I loved it and played it all the time, and this just turned out. One way in, one way out. Hmm. Funny thing, I read an interview with Carlos when he recorded Daughter of the Night, and they asked him, "Why, Carlos, why did you record that song?" And he answered, "Well, it reminds me of my childhood, you know, the feeling, the sounds in the alleys when I was a kid." And I remember writing the song, it was in Stockholm, it was a very snowy winter, February night. It's a bit, how could that sort of remind him of the village in Mexico?
You liked his version?
Yeah, absolutely. Richie Havens recorded it as well.
Yeah, and Jim Capaldi as well?
Jim Capaldi too, yeah. But I like Carlos' version.
Do you know how Carlos heard of the song?
You never know that, you know. It's the music publisher said that we... you know, we sound him this and that, but I'm not sure. I think he actually heard my version on some radio station.
One way out, you don't know.
One of the other solo tracks that I want to ask you about is Dancing on the Edge of Danger, and you also wrote that with Hans.
Yeah.
So that seems to have a bit of a J.J. Cale influence. Is he an artist that you were influenced by?
Yeah, absolutely. First time I heard him was on a tour in America, in Seattle. I heard him on the radio, you know, on the car radio. Almost went off the road. And that was a song called Lies.
Right.
And after that, I sort of, you know, everything he did, I loved it. And we're still playing J.J. Cale now and then, you know, on tours. So, that Dancing on the Edge of Danger has that sort of little monotone feel of it and rhythm. And also a little disco.
You and Hans struck up such a good songwriting partnership. Was it obvious when you first started writing with him that you would continue to work with him for a long time?
Oh, yeah, we've been writing. I mean, the first song we wrote was Daughter of the Night in 1975, and that's 48 years ago. So, but as I said, you know, we still write songs, and on this new live LP that we are releasing in April, we have at least, I think, 8 songs that we wrote together, if not more. We'll be right back.
One of the other things about your career that is good is that you continue to develop your sound as time passes, and Tender Turns Tough is a really good example because it's more new wave.
Yeah, it was a bit. I started listening on, you know, The Clash, for instance, and I thought that, I like that. And I also had this new band with fantastic musicians. So we did that together. We actually sort of improvised a lot of songs, like and then Turns Tough to more or less improvisation.
Did you focus on playing in Sweden, or did you go to other Scandinavian countries or onto the continent in Europe?
Mostly in Sweden. Some in Norway, Finland, and also down in Germany, and Holland, Spain. But mostly in Sweden during the summer time, because we had something called the Swedish Folk Parks. That was a huge organization. Fantastic venue, and unfortunately they're all starting to fall apart now for some reason, but that was the sort of main scene for us, was during the summer in the folk parks. And then after the folk parks, every city should have their own city festival. We sort of took over from the folk parks and became almost even more popular. So that's where we are, and it's still the summertime that's the most when we work the most, so to speak.
Another fantastic artist who's covered or recorded your songs is Cyndi Lauper, and she recorded You first released that a few years earlier yourself?
Yes, I did. I think it was just a half a year earlier or something like that, or maybe a year, because I was in California recording on Record Plant, And behind there somewhere, there's a bar. And a friend of mine came in and said, there's a girl called Cyndi Lauper who wants to record Yeah, Yeah. I said, yeah, fantastic. Because at that time, I didn't know who she was, you know.
Yeah.
But she recorded it, and it was on this Girl Just Wanna Have Fun. And it was a huge success, yeah.
That must have been amazing.
Yeah, it was, because actually she had a party somewhere close to the record plant. And somebody played my record on this party to her. And that's how she heard it first.
Her album, She's So Unusual, is now preserved in the Library of Congress as one of the most important albums in United States history. So with your song on it, that's incredible.
Yeah, it is. Actually, both Hans and I are invited to the Congress Library. Totally Swedish, except for Birgit Nilsson, a famous opera singer.
Wow.
Yeah, I was really surprised there.
Another huge song for you is Finger. So we're getting to the late 1980s now. That's a song, the message that you were wanting to get across with that song is quite important in that it was it about not being materialistic?
Yes, it is. This was during the Yuppie era.
Yuppie, yeah.
Everybody, Yuppie era, everybody was driving around in shining porches and, So I met with a friend I haven't seen for 10 years, and we met outside a pub, and we went in and started to talk about what happened. So he asked me, well, if you had any money, what would you do? So I don't know. I don't need anything, really. Well, a pair of wings that could fly out and do something more like that.
It got to number one in Sweden, didn't it?
Oh, yeah. For a long time. Still scream, you know. If I don't play that song on my concerts, you know, we will be very, very upset.
That song was written with a different songwriting partner?
Yeah, a guy called Peter Lindfors is not with us anymore, unfortunately. But yeah, we wrote quite a lot, many songs, almost all the songs on that album. And also when I started this band, Grimlings, they wrote a couple of, well, a lot of songs to that band too.
Köpa vingar för pengarna och flyga ut över ängarna. Och när jag flugit 1000 mil ska jag flyga 1000 till för att göra det man måste och göra det man vill.
Start now. Oh yeah.
You mentioned Grimlings.
Yeah.
You'll have to pronounce the Swedish here, but it's My Best for You.
Yeah, Mitt Bästa för dig. My Best for You, yeah. It was also number one for a long time here.
That's a super group of different famous Swedish singers and musicians.
Yeah, it is. You know, because I had this dream that once, you know, maybe when I can afford it, I'm going to buy a big farm. Mm-hmm. And when I could afford it, I bought a big farm. And the dream was to invite friends and colleagues for a couple of weeks or a month during the summer. And I had a studio. We wrote songs, we recorded songs. And all of a sudden, it was we were a super band. So that was great. It was like a little small hippie. You know, everybody came down with the kids and dogs and cats and grandma and grandpa. So it was like a hippie community. It was an absolutely great time. I think we did three albums, but the first one was the most popular.
Säger ja eller nej. Jag sätter mitt allt, mitt bästa för dig. Skuggorna ljuger och går förbi. Möter sitt eget tyranneri. De kan du glömma, lyssna på mig. Sätter mitt liv, mitt bästa för dig.
så kvar. Vad om jag säger ja eller nej, sätter mitt allt, mitt bästa för dig.
So now we've got Percy Sledge and Blue Knight. What was the connection with Percy Sledge? Because that's a song that you wrote with Hans again, isn't it?
Yeah, right. Well, during the time in America, we had came across a fantastic guy called Saul Davis. He was the head of public relations during this our first tour, but he's been my friend ever since. He was one of the producers for this Percy Sledge comeback. He called me and asked if I had any songs. I sent him some songs. Blue Knight was one of them. I'm still in touch, not very often, but now and then. And after Blue Knight, Percy's album after that was Shining Through the Rain, which I wrote too.
You also sung with Percy Sledge. Did you actually get to meet him?
Oh, yeah. We were toured together.
Was that in Europe or in the United States?
In Europe. Yeah, he was fantastic. Great person to work with, you know. Very humble, very.
Winners call.
We now have a song that you co-wrote with Paul Jones of Manfred Mann, When He Comes. So what was the connection with Paul Jones? Was that Sol Davis again or someone else?
Yeah, Sol Davis, because Sol Davis' wife, Carl Olson, I think she produced it. This Social Over, and we wrote this song actually in the studio and recorded. I think Eric Clapton was there as played the guitar too at the Olympic, I think it was.
Oh, the famous London Studios Olympic.
Yeah, I don't think it's there anymore.
No,
I think we were one of the last recordings there, but that was fun. The thing is that I haven't heard the song since then. You know, I tried to find it on Spotify. But I didn't find it.
So you went over to London to record with Paul?
Yeah.
Did you write in person with him as well?
Yeah, I mean, we wrote that song together, When He Comes, I think it was called, yeah. So we wrote that song in the studio and recorded it, but I haven't heard it since then. It would be nice to hear.
Now's the time to...
Yeah. That would be lovely to hear.
Yeah.
I can't remember it.
That man you're looking for, he's been here and gone. Yes, that man you're looking for, he's been here and gone. Oh, but don't let that throw you down. He will return. He'll return before too long. No way of knowing when he might come back again. No way of knowing when he might be back again. When he comes back, I know. When he comes back, I know. That's gonna be for his friends. Lots of people just waiting for his return. Yeah, there's whole lots of people all around. waiting for his return. Yeah, but when he comes back, suddenly like a burglar, there's something you got to learn. Got to learn.
I also wanted to close the podcast with another one of your more recent songs. Look For Me, Angel is a lovely song of yours.
Yeah, and that song is actually on the same production as this first song, Reason Why. Those are sort of the sound that I have right now.
So what's the plans for your forthcoming album then? Did you say it's coming in a few months?
Yeah, in April. Yeah, well, you know, we're planning tours, of course, and some TV shows here in Sweden. The record business and the music business is a bit slow at the moment. It's hard to plan too long ahead. Hopefully, I'll get this great band together and get some concerts during the summer, spring and summer.
So the plan is basically to keep writing songs, recording and playing live?
Yeah, that's the plan. And the thing is, you know, when the corona started, I thought, wow, now I got time. I can write a lot of songs. But in 2.5 years, I didn't even touch the guitar.
Ah.
And many of my colleagues, the same, you know, they just lost it. But it's slowly coming back.
That's great to hear. Well, Mikael, thank you so much for your time. It's such a pleasure and privilege to speak with you today. Thank you again.
Thank you, Justin.
Look for me, angel, shine your light on me, show some comfort for a stranger, set my spirit free. I've been slipping into darkness, I've been howling at the moon, so look for me, angel, and bring me homeward soon. So look for me, angel, I'm lying on the ground, used to fly like an eagle, but a hunter shut me down. I had golden wings of freedom, but I tore my soul apart. So look for me, angel, and mend my broken heart. Back to life again. Help me with my broken wing. Bring me back to life again. Lift me from this place. So look for me, angel, my flame is burning low, the sun is slowly setting, got no place left to go, and I'm hoping you'll remember the way I was before. So look for me, angel, and open up your door.
Thank you for listening to the Strange Brew podcast. If you do like the show, please consider a small donation to help keep the show archive online. It's 10 years since I started the podcast, and hosting fees are increasing over time. All your support keeps the show running and helps me get amazing guests. To support me, just go to thestrangebrew.co.uk, where you'll see a donate button on the homepage. Thank you very much. Plus, any reviews on your podcast services help to spread the word too. Thank you.